Welcome to the church family that is lifting lives through living love, inspiring hope, filling with faith, and transforming our world. These recorded messages are made available so that you might have additional opportunities to stay connected with us and that you might learn and grow in your faith. God bless you as you hear the word today. And now, the message.
Good morning. My name is Reed Walker. I'm but a poor substitute for Ken Price. Michael W. Smith said it this way about Scripture, this being one of the centerpieces of the New Testament. Ancient words ever true, changing me, changing you. We have come with open hearts. Lord, let your sacred word impart. Jesus says in the second of the parables of lost things, or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully and diligently until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me. I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and hearing of this word.
So Pixie is a company, there's a handful of companies like this, and they make things that help us find stuff that we misplace. And so in 2017, they wanted to do some market research to find out, well, what are the objects that Americans most easily and most often misplace and lose? And so they did kind of a nationwide survey, and from that survey, I have a top 10 list of items that Americans most frequently lose. And so this is going to be some audience participation as we begin our message today. I'm going to invite you to shout out items that you think we lose. And let me just be clear, this is items. It's not kids or dogs or losing your mind. In the 9:30 service, someone said losing our dreams, which I thought was very dark. So we're talking about physical items that you can misplace. So go ahead, give me some thoughts. What do we tend to misplace? Oh, okay. I heard keys. That's the number one answer. So you guys can give yourself a round of applause. You got the number one answer. Woo! But let's keep going. Let's see what else we can get. I got my little cheat sheet here. What else do we misplace? Glasses. Number five was glasses. What else? Wallet. Number two. And then I heard someone say phone. Let me see. Phone is number four. Doesn't that make you curious? What is number three? What are we missing here? So far we got keys, wallet, phone, glasses. What else? Purse. So let me just add, wallet included all money-related things. So purses, credit cards. That's why it was number two, because it was kind of inclusive of all those things. Okay, what else? Car? Oh, and the parking lot. I was like, how do you misplace a car in the parking lot? That wasn't one of the list, but I like where you're thinking, because we all go out in the parking lot sometimes and we just hit our button holding it up, trying to find it, but that was not on the list. They're thinking of household items inside the house, I guess. What else? Socks was number eight. Socks, which I don't think we lose. I think the dryer eats them. What else? That's number three. Ding, 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 ding. The TV remote. What else? Umbrella. Good guess. Not on the list. What was that? Someone said gloves. It pins. No, pins is not, neither is gloves. These are good guesses. I'll do one more. Shoes was not. I see where you go with that with socks. I'll do one more guess. Jewelry is on the list, number 7. Jewelry. Anyone else have? Watch. That watch counts as jewelry. So, okay, I'll give you the remaining 3 answers. Have you ever seen Family Feud? Whenever they flip it over, the whole audience kind of says it. So, number 10, toys. You guys know, and if you don't know yet, you soon will know, you're always losing a stuffed animal or something, and Lord help if it's her favorite, you know. Number 9, this was the one that surprised me. I didn't think of, but until I saw it on the internet, but number 9, nail clippers, which I can never find them. They're just not that important. Well, I mean, you know, anyways, moving on. Number 6, makeup or chapstick. They kind of combine those, makeup or chapstick. Okay, there you go. There you have it, the top 10 things that Americans reported. So this is our self-reporting that we lose. These are some interesting statistics also. So this same survey tells us that the average American will spend 2.5 days every year looking for lost things. 2.5 days of your life, gone because you were looking for something that's lost. Listen to this. Collectively, Americans spend $2.7 billion each year to replace things that we lost. 60% of Americans report they've arrived late at work because of something they've lost. 50% say they've missed an appointment or meeting because they couldn't find something. 20% say they've missed a flight because they either misplaced a ticket or luggage. So, and like I said, that doesn't even include like children and pets and our minds. So we have an epidemic of losing things in our country. But here's the thing, all these things, I'm sure every single one of us could raise our hand that we have lost one of these things. But we didn't lose any of them because they had no value to us. I mean, some of these things, especially like jewelry, have tremendous value. No, we don't lose things on purpose. We lose them by inattention, by preoccupation. We weren't really thinking about it when we set that thing down, and so we can't remember where we put it down. Or our eyes just moved away, and so we were focused on something else, and we didn't see when that remote slipped down into the couch cushions. It's just because we are preoccupied with other things that we lose things. But here's the thing is, when we lose things, well, even though they still have value, what happens is they begin to feel unvalued. There's a whole movie franchise made around this. I'm speaking of the Toy Story movies, which this summer released its 4th one. But every single one of the movies centers around some object, some toy that gets misplaced. I can't show you a clip from the 4th one because it's still in theaters, and some of you may not have seen it yet. But the 3rd one, I can show you a clip from that. Take a look at this. This is a little short clip. It's Lotso's story.
Daisy loved us all, but Lotso was special. They did everything together. You never seen a kid and a toy more in love. One day we took a drive, hit a rest stop, had a little playtime. After lunch, Daisy fell asleep. Lotso wouldn't give up. It took forever, but we finally made it back to Daisy's. But by then, it was too late.
So Lotso had value. He was special. He was Daisy's favorite toy. But did you see what happened when he got lost? It wasn't on purpose, it was just by accident. But what happened when he got lost and replaced is suddenly he didn't feel valued anymore. I mean, this is the irony that we don't lose things because they have no value, but lost things feel unvalued. And I'm not here talking about inanimate objects or toys. We know none of these things have feelings, but people do have feelings. And when people get lost, they feel it. I left my book right up here, but one of my favorite books is called Same Kind of Different as Me. It's a true story written by Ron Hall and Denver Moore of their friendship together. It's an unlikely friendship. Ron is a successful art dealer, a man of wealth and business, and he befriends a man named Denver, who happened to be a homeless man. Their friendship began when Ron started volunteering with his wife at a homeless shelter, the particular homeless shelter where Denver often was a client. But every time he tried to reach out and express friendship and kindness to Ron, or whenever Ron did that towards Denver, Denver always kind of rebuffed him, you know, gave him the Heisman, like was not interested at all. And Ron couldn't figure out, what's wrong with me? Why doesn't he like me? And finally, one day, Denver had an honest conversation with him. It went like this. Denver began by saying, "Sir, I heard that when white folks go fishing, they do something called catch and release." "Catch and release?" I, Ron, nodded solemnly, suddenly nervous and curious at the same time. "Well, this bothers me," Denver went on. "I just can't figure it out. Because when colored folks go fishing, we're really proud of what we catch. We take it and we show it off to everybody that'll look. And then we eat what we catch. In other words, we use it to sustain us. So it really bothers me that white folks would go to all this trouble to catch a fish, and then when they done caught it, just throw it back in the water." He paused again, and the silence between us stretched a full minute. Then he said, "Did you hear me?" I nodded. I was afraid to speak, afraid to offend. Denver looked away, searching the sky, and then he locked onto me again. "So, Mr. Ron, it occurs to me, if you was fishing for a friend you just gonna catch and release, then I ain't got no desire to be your friend." But then his eyes gentled and he spoke more softly than before. "But if he was looking for a real friend, then I'll be one forever." Denver is speaking an important truth to Ron. And part of that truth is he's expressing that the experience of having been released over and over and over again has changed his heart. The experience of being released is painful. And you get released enough, you stop trusting other people. You start to wonder if you have any value inside. But his words are convicting because he's also pointing out a pattern of relationships that he's seen in others and that he doesn't want to replicate. And for me, at least, it's very convicting because I think about so many relationships, so many friendships I have that I've released over the years. Not by intention, not because they didn't have value or worth. No, I released them by inattention because I got so caught up in my own life that I forgot to stay in touch with what was happening in the life of someone else, someone I really did care about. I mean, this is the irony. People and relationships have value, but when that relationship or that connection gets lost, it's easy for people to conclude that, that value that it once had, maybe it was never there to begin with. Maybe they never really cared. We're in the second week of a three-week series about lost and found. We're looking at the three stories in Luke 15, the lost and found department of Luke's gospel. Jesus tells three stories, and each of these stories talks about something that gets lost. The first story, it's a sheep who wanders away from the flock, and the shepherd leaves the 99 to go and seek and save that sheep. In today's story, it's about 10 coins, one of which gets lost, and a woman searches through the house in order to find it. And then next week, we'll talk about the last story, which is about two sons, one of whom goes off and gets lost. and the father waits patiently in order to receive him back. The stories are interesting. I think they're put in that order for a couple of reasons. One, notice how the scale of the story seems to shrink. The first story, it's 100 sheep, one of whom gets lost. And the next story, it's 10 coins. And the final story, it's 2 brothers. The scale keeps getting more and more personal. And even beyond that, notice the pattern. In the first story, the sheep gets lost out there. And the second story, the coin gets lost in here. It's possible to get lost inside the house. And in the third story, you have one brother who gets lost out there and another brother who gets lost in here. You see that pattern, how it's laid out? Last week, Seth talked about the out there, about how easy it is for us as a church to lose connection with the world around us, for us to lose connection with the neighbors who live right among us. And so he encouraged us to take practical steps to rebuild that connection, to go on prayer walks in our community, to find ways of expressing friendship and care for our neighbors. If you weren't here last week, I encourage you to check it out on the website and do some of the things that he recommended for us to do. But this week, we're going to talk about the second story. And the second story makes us reflect on how easy it is to get lost inside the church. It happens very easily, doesn't it? I mean, I think for one thing, when we come to church, it's easy to feel like everyone else is found, perhaps. I mean, because all we see when we come to church is we see people's outsides. We see people smiling, shaking hands, looking like they belong. And if you're feeling insecure or unsure, then it's easy to conclude that you're the only one who's feeling that way. Years ago, when I was a hospital chaplain, I had a mentor who gave me some advice. I was feeling unsure, inadequate, when I would go into some of the especially the ICU. ICU is such a bustling place, and all the nurses, all the doctors, they looked so confident and sure of what they were doing, and I wasn't sure where I fit in all that. And my supervisor says, David, we have this tendency as human beings to compare our insides with other people's outsides. It could be that these nurses and doctors that you're so intimidated by, that they're just as unsure, just as afraid, you know, as you are, but you're missing it because all you're seeing is what's on the outside. And I think that's especially true in church. When we come to church, all we see is the outsides, and everyone puts on this brave, smiling face, but inside we all might be struggling. I know, I get the prayer requests that you guys fill out every week. And so I know in our church there are people dealing with sickness, people dealing with family trouble, and it's easy to assume that I'm the only one with this problem, but I could promise you, I can tell you, if you're feeling lost today, you are not the only one. And beyond that, though, I think it's easy for us to lose people who were once in the church but perhaps have wandered away. You know, life happens. Life happens, and sometimes people get sick, or sometimes people just get busy, or maybe something's going on in their family, or maybe they're dealing with an issue, but for a period of time, they miss church for 3-4 weeks. It goes by really fast. And then they look up and they say, you know, I've been gone from church for a month, and no one seems to have noticed. No one reached out and said, hey, where you been? No one asked, no one expressed that they missed me. And it's easy again for people to conclude, well, if I just stopped coming to church, would anyone notice? Would anyone care? Let me be clear that I believe, I so desperately desire for our church to be a place where everyone feels value and belonging. I think those are the most powerful, two of the most powerful needs we have as human beings, to find a place where we belong. And when we find where we belong, it gives us value. And our church is that's one of the best things that we can offer people. But in order for us to offer value and belonging to people, then we have to seek out the lost. Just like the story, the woman turns on the light, she searches everywhere. The translation says she searches with care, carefully, full of care. We have to be on the constant lookout for those who are getting lost. And that may mean, for instance, calling someone that you haven't seen for a while. Every once in a while, someone will come up to me and say, "Pastor Dave, do you know how so-and-so is doing?" And I'll say, "I don't know. Well, I haven't noticed them in church. I thought you may know what's going on in their lives." The reality is that you are going to notice before I do who is here and who's not here. And then they'll say, "You know, maybe you should reach out to them." And I'm always happy to do that. In some cases, people will say to me, "You know, this person used to attend here over a year ago before I started here as your pastor, but they haven't been here in the last year. I think it would mean a lot if you reached out to them as a pastor." And I'm always happy to do that because I do think for many people, it does mean a lot. But let me tell you what means more. It means more when you do it. When they get a call from a friend that they may have lost touch with saying, "You know, I miss you. How you been?" Don't ask someone where they've been. That makes them put someone on the defensive, like, "Where you been?" You know, just say, "Hey, I haven't seen you in a while. Are you doing okay? How are you doing?" Sometimes making that simple call is all it takes for someone to realize that they feel valued and cared for. It might be this morning, you can look around and you can think of two or three people that used to be around you, but you haven't seen in a while. Will you call them this week? Will you just say, "I miss seeing you. Are you doing okay?" And don't, you know, put any pressure. It's not about guilting anyone about missing church. It's just expressing value to them. And not only do we have to express value to those who are here and may have wandered away, we also have to express value to those who are new to our church. Because it takes a lot of courage to walk through those doors for the first time. I mean, for me, I hate going into movie theaters by myself. You know, like when you walk into a movie theater and everyone else seems to be sitting together chatting and you feel so awkward. And that's in a dark place where we're all looking at a screen. This is a bright place where people are all shaking hands. It's intimidating to come in those doors, and it makes all the difference if someone reaches out to you and says, "It's nice to meet you. I don't know if we've met before. My name is David." And it may be that they've been attending church here for a while and you just never met before, and that's okay, you've made a new friend, but we have to go that extra mile of introducing ourselves. And beyond that, if they are new to the church, saying, "Well, hey, let me walk you to the information desk. Let me introduce you to Marlene or Don or one of our team members that's there. Or let me walk you down to the children's department if they have children. Let me show you where you're supposed to go." It's going that extra mile, inviting someone to a Bible study you're involved with, or to a service project that you do, or just inviting them to coffee or lunch. That little invitation communicates to people that they belong, that they have value. In his prayer, Perry lifted up Bob Dean, who passed away yesterday. I think of Bob as one of the most outgoing people I've ever met at Zionsville United Methodist Church. When I first came here as a new pastor, you know, there's some intimidation in being a new pastor. And the first morning when I saw Bob, Bob's 96 years old, he sang in the choir, he's kind of this stately gentleman, but he's so warm and generous. And the first time I saw him, he put his arms out and he said, "Come on in, Pastor, I want to give you a hug." And then he said, "I'm a hugger, just so you know." And then every week, he and Ann would come through the line, and every week he'd say, "I need my hug, Dave, I need my hug, bring it in." And so we'd give that hug. You know, when you're new to a church, now I know not everyone loves hugs. You know, you may not be a hugger, and that's okay if you're not. But it just made me feel so welcome because that hug was offered before he ever heard me preach, before he knew if I was a good pastor or not. It was unconditional. And when I visited him Friday, he passed away Saturday. When I visited him Friday, there in the rehab center where he was, we sat and we talked for a few minutes. And then as I got ready to leave, he said, "Hey, Dave." I turned around and he said, "I love you." I said, "I love you too, Bob." But I don't think I would have said "I love you too" if he hadn't said it first. Those were the last words he spoke to me. That's what we're supposed to do to each other. To express love. To express care. To the open arms of God saying, "You have value, you're welcome here. You belong with us." We do it because that's who Jesus says God is. We extend ourselves in that way because Jesus says this is what God is like. God is like a woman who would search through the house, turn it top to bottom, turn it over until she found the coin that was lost. Because just because something's lost doesn't mean that it's lost its value. And what I love is when the woman finds the coin, what does she do? She celebrates. She calls her friends over. She throws a party for them. And this was always the funny thing to me, because there's this part of me, it's like, really? Over a coin? Like, who throws a party over a coin? It's nothing. It's just an object. And in fact, I always imagine that she spends more money on the party than she did over the value of that coin. Like, why would she do that? But I think that's what we're supposed to reflect on. I think Jesus wants us to remember that every coin, just like every person, has value. And just because a coin is lost doesn't mean that the coin has lost its value. It's just missing from our life at the time. And the celebration is when the value that was inherent in the coin has been reclaimed and redeemed and found again. I saw a video this past annual conference that our bishop, Bishop Trimble, shared with the conference, and it captured this idea so perfectly that I don't think I can outdo the speaker in this video. So I'm just going to share the same video with you. It's by a guy named Byron Lionel Scott. Check this out.
This is a dollar bill. Now, if I go to the store and there's something for 90 cents, can I buy it with this dollar bill? Okay, all right. So if I go to the store and there's something for 85 cents and after tax, it ends up being 96 cents, can I buy it with this dollar bill? Okay, all right. So what if I ball the dollar bill up? Think about it now. Like, I just ball the dollar bill up. Like, so it can't be worth a dollar now. It's probably worth like 95 cents, right? How much do you think it's worth? A dollar. Listen, y'all gotta pay attention. I just balled it up. So clearly it's not worth a dollar anymore. All right. So maybe, what if I step on it? What if I stomp it? I just stomped it. How much is it worth now? Maybe 65 cents, 68 cents? It's still worth a dollar? Okay, what if I ball it up? What if I stomp on it? And then I put it in the trash can. And it's in here with some trash. And it's around some beer and some gum and a bunch of other nasty stuff. And some guy off the street pulls the dollar out, unfolds it. How much is it worth now? Maybe 82 cents? And at least 92 cents? It's okay, all right, so what if I ball it up? What if I step on it? What if I put it in trash? And then, watch this, I tear it in half. Think about it now, right? How much is it worth now? A dollar? I could tape it? Wait. Wait a second. I just balled it up. I just stepped on it. I put it in trash. I pulled it out. Then I tore it in half. And you mean to tell me I can pick the dollar up, I can wipe it off, and I can put some tape around it, and it's still worth a dollar? Then why? If this dollar doesn't lose its worth or its value, then why do you feel like you've lost your worth and value? Because many of you feel like you've been stepped on, you feel like you've been pushed aside, you feel like you've been abandoned, you feel like you've been talked about, you feel like you've been abused, like someone took from you, someone hurt you, somebody took advantage of you, and deep down inside your core, you feel like you've lost some of your value. And I am here to tell you today that this dollar still has worth and value. Because there are some men years ago who put value over this life and said that no matter what happens to it, it can still be taped back together. It can still be wiped off. And I am here to tell you that you were created and you're born and you're here and you have life and you have purpose and you have value. And though you've gone through some hard times and though you've experienced some depression and you might be wanting to hurt yourself or you might want to give up, I am here to tell you you still got worth and value. And there is nothing that can happen that can take your worth and your value away.
Amen. Amen. I don't know that I can add a whole lot to that. I'll just say this one little thing. You ever heard someone talk about being redeemed? Like, I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. You ever heard that phrase? What does that mean, to be redeemed? To be redeemed is it's a financial, it's a monetary term. If I have a coupon in my pocket, I take it to the store and I redeem it. I claim its value. So to be redeemed is to have your value claimed and restored. How do you do that in someone? What restores someone's value? It's love. When someone knows that they are loved, their value is restored. When someone sees something in someone else that is worth loving, it communicates value. And so my message to you is that your value has been redeemed by Jesus, because he loved you so much that he was willing to die on a cross for you. And our value doesn't come from the clothes we wear or the money we make or the success we have or even how perfect we are as Christians. Our value doesn't come from any of those things. Our value comes from a Savior who loved us so much, a God who loved us so much that he would give his only begotten Son in exchange for our lives. We are redeemed by his grace. Our value is eternally secure. And then we are called to live in a way that values, that sees and communicates that value to everyone that we meet. So if you are new to our church, I am so glad you're here today. And I want you to know you have value. And I hope someday you'll feel emboldened to take a step into some Bible study or some relationship or friendship here where you can find that belonging affirmed. Perhaps you've been here for a long time and you look around and you've seen a lot of change and you don't recognize all the faces that are around you, or you're not sure what you contribute to the church. I want you to know you have value, and I'm so glad you are here. Every single one of us has value, and especially if you feel like that message is for someone else. Anyone else, that's true of, but for me, you don't know what I've done, you don't know what's happened to me. I want you to know God loves you. And if you're feeling lost today, you're in the right place, because the church is the place where lost things get found, where we encounter a God who will search high and low, and who, when he finds us, celebrates over us, because our value to him is immeasurable. Amen. Amen. Will you join me in praying? Almighty God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for the gift of your Son, for his life which secures our value, for his love which in your grace will never end. And we know, O God, that we can't earn your love. There's nothing we could do to earn it. It's just given to us freely, and we humbly, gratefully accept it, Lord. And we ask that you let it transform our lives and transform our hearts. Help it change, O God, the way we see one another. I pray, God, for anyone in this room who's feeling lost, may they know that they are in the right place, that through your Son and through your love, we can all get found. Help us, O God, to live out this mission you have given us through your Son to seek and save the lost. All this we pray in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.